A very good evening to all of you. I'm the moderator of today's session, Pesala Velangalla, from the IEEE student branch of the University of Moratuwa. How to make a job mini resume is a wonderful opportunity catered to our university students. This is an event under Rise Up More, a novel initiative by the IEEE student branch of the University of Moratuwa, aiming to improve the soft skills of students. I warmly welcome everyone who is joining us today. First and foremost, in order to commence the webinar, I cordially invite the co-chairperson of the webinar, Mudita Dilshad. Over to you.
Thank you, Pesala. Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's session. You all may have wondered once, at least once in your university life, how should I write my CV, how to face an interview, and how to improve soft skills. Offering the perfect opportunity to improve soft skills, IEEE student branch of the University of Moratuwa initiated this novel program, Rise Up More. Under Rise Up More, we are presenting you two webinars, one on the title, How to Write a Job in Resume, and other on the title, How to Excel an Interview. And we have organized a mock interview series also, but due to limited facilities, we are unable to extend it with all of you guys. It is open for 18th batch of University of Moratuwa. Presenting you the phase one of Rise Up More. I would like to welcome you all. First, I would like to warmly welcome our keynote speaker, Engineer Zara Mazu, Electrical Engineer at Ceylon Electricity Board. Your presence today is an honor to us, madam. And I would like to welcome all the participants to today's event. Your participation is most appreciated. Hope you all will enjoy the meeting. Thank you, and over to you, Pesala.
Thank you, Mudit. I would like to remind you all to keep your microphones muted during the main session to avoid any disturbances. You can ask the questions related to the topic once the Q&A session starts using either the Zoom chat box or through Facebook comments. If you want to voice your concerns, first send a message via our Zoom chat box saying that you want to ask a question, and upon your name being called, you can unmute yourself and ask your question. I hope everything is clear. So, on to the session. A great CV is of paramount importance in today's wildly competitive job market. It is your first chance to make a good impression on a potential employer and is your most valuable tool to get to the job interview stage. To give us valuable insight on how to write a job mini CV, we have an outstanding personality here with us today. Let me take the pleasure of introducing the guest speaker for the evening, Madam Zara Mazu. Being an alumna of the University of Rungunam, where she obtained her BSc in Electrical and Information Engineering, Madam Mazu currently serves as an electrical engineer at Ceylon Electricity Board, currently working in the Projects and Heavy Maintenance Branch, Distribution Division 1 of CEB. She recently earned her MBA from the Open University of Sri Lanka. She is also the winner of the IET Young Woman Engineer Award Sri Lanka in 2019. Madam Mazu is the Assistant Secretary for the IESL Young Members Sectional Committee, and she is also an EXO member of IESL Uttaram District Center and IESL Women Engineers Forum. Madam, it is an honor to have you here with us today. I'm sure your vast knowledge and experience in this regard will help everyone who's joining us immensely. Over to you, madam.
The pleasure and honor is mine, actually. Thank you for inviting me to be the keynote speaker. In any case, if my internet connection is unstable, I will switch off the video while I'm sharing my screen. So, although you told me that I'm a very experienced person, truth be told, I'm a 7 years experienced person in Ceylon Electricity Board. But my experience in when it comes to helping others get their jobs is with helping their within their CVs, actually. So as a senior engineer from our university, actually, I get a lot of CVs from my juniors to be corrected, to go through and reviewed and corrected sometimes. I find a lot of mistakes in them. Simple things that can be very deleterious to your career. But actually for you guys, because you have invited me to share my knowledge, and I'm always open to sharing my knowledge in whatever thing I learn. So while sharing the screen, I will switch off the video for the best bandwidth. So I'll start sharing my screen. If there's any technical issue, just let me know. You can disturb me anytime. So let's go on straight to the presentation. So simply speaking, how to make a job winning resume. So I'm an electrical engineer. I have 7 years experience in the Ceylon Electricity Board. So now you are in your second year. Most of you are in second year. I know there might be undergraduates from other years as well, but I am targeting the second year undergraduates who are going to go to the industrial training this year. So after your degree, what are your options? First thing, you can go to the industry and become start a career in the industry. Or you can go to academia, become a lecturer, and pursue your path as an academic. If not, you also can choose the path of an entrepreneur. So these are the mainly three options that you currently have. Maybe in the future you will have more. So Zig Ziglar said, you can't hit a target that you can't see. So you can't hit a hard target you can't see. So you have to see the target clearly. So what is your target? Do you clearly have a target? I meet a lot of students, undergraduates, who don't have a clear idea what they are going to do. For example, some of them, half of their heart wants to do a PhD or MSc for higher studies. Half of their heart wants to go for the industry. But you have to select exactly what you want to do. It's either the industry or academia. But later on halfway through, when you have gone to the industry, you might feel like getting to the academia. Or vice versa. So first of all, you have to have a clear path where you're going to go. Plan. And as you can see, 20% of us have goals and 80% of us don't have goals. So this is the real picture. So it's time that we really ask from ourselves what we really need and focus on that. So that is the first thing I wanted to tell you. Now, let's look at the skills in the skills market that are in focus. You can see in 2015, I have taken credible data. In 2015, there was a set of skills related with others, people management, and so on. When it comes to 2020, that means actually last year, slight changes can be noticed. For example, critical thinking has become more important. And look at creativity. It was in the number 10 in 2015 that it has come to the first three, people management. And there is a new skill that you have to focus on, which is emotional intelligence. Now, as you know, when you go to the industry and even in academia, you work with people. Working with people is very different to working with machines. So you have to have some kind of intelligence about how people behave. So emotional intelligence is also now very important. So these are the data collected by the World 2025. The same report predicted that these three skills will become top priority: critical thinking and analysis, problem solving, skills in self-management. Now, it is very important that we manage ourselves in learning, in resilience. For example, if you lose your job, you should be able to come back. This is a great problem that we experienced during the last year due to the pandemic situation. So you have to be resilient. You have the ability to come back even after losing your job. And tolerating stress. Unlike earlier, now our jobs are very stressful. and flexibility. Okay, so companies estimate that around 40% of workers will require reskilling of 6 months or less. That means they will have to reskill themselves. That means change their skills, adapt new skills into their system within 6 months. And 94% of business leaders report that they expect employees to pick up a new skill on the job. So it's not like you learn everything and go to the job, but you end up going to the job and learning a new skill. So now, how powerful is your CV? Let me tell you some important things about your CV. Number one, recruiters, I mean 6 seconds, think about that. It's a very short time and they are scanning your CV within that time for the filtering, for the first filtering process. So you might make it to the next list or not. And most recruiters focus on the center of the resume when scanning. This is where your work experience and your qualifications come. Also, white spaces are important. Although you think that white spaces are not important, they are important. So you have to carefully keep some spaces in between your text. Sometimes you tend to bullet everything. So when you bullet the important things among the unimportant things, then the unimportant things also become important and the focus is lost and you are failing to draw attention to the most important things. And you should avoid pronouns like I, me, she, or he in your CV. And less is more. I have seen curriculum videos. I'm not having a bad thing with the creativity, but when there are too many colors, too much graphics, it's very distracting. So try to keep it simple, formal, and easy to go through. And to be honest, you are applying for a job after a bachelor's degree. Is it necessary to list out all your school achievements? I think not. So focus on the most important thing and you can remove the unnecessary things like, you know, your where you participated in the hump parcel competitions, things like that, you can drop them off. Okay, and further interest. You think this is not important, but for some employees, this part is very important because that is where they see what you do in your free time as a person. Are you focused on your self-development? Are you just wasting your time in your free time? These are the things that they tend to focus on. So if you are a volunteer, if you are a Toastmaster sometimes, if you are a keynote speaker, if you are doing social activities, that will definitely tell something about yourself to your employees, that you have greater capacity working with people, skills like that. And problem solving skills are equally important. Team working. Now, some jobs require negotiation. So for example, if you are going to sign a contract, you might need to negotiate a cost. So someone who is providing you the service might first establish a large amount. You might need to, on behalf of your company, go and discuss with them and bring the price down to a lower ceiling price. So in that case, you need good negotiation skills. And also, sound written and verbal communication skills. So please, while you are in your university, focus on improving your written and verbal communication skills, because I have seen very senior engineers sometimes who are unable to pen down a letter, which is very important skill for engineers. So you should be able to communicate properly with the stakeholders. Sometimes your subordinates, sometimes your colleagues, sometimes outside people. So you have to develop your communication skills. And my dear students, nowadays, this is very important, ethics and professionalism. So ethics is something that we learn in IESL Code of Ethics as well, but we have to keep in mind to practice them as well. So there are things like conflict of interest, and sometimes when we try to do things that we are not expert in that area as well, it's not ethical. So let's try to be good people overall and inculcate the good ethics as well, and always be professional. So you have to maintain the image of an engineer in the society. So you know that doctors have a very good image in the society. If we can maintain that image of a good engineer in the society, then you are halfway there. Although you have not got the job or got the job, you're halfway there. And time and resource management. Now, you know, we talk about sustainability and environment protection and everything like that, but it's all about managing your risk. We have finances, but as engineers, we have to manage them carefully without wasting them, including time. So now let's come to the most important part. I am sure you might have heard there are two words that are used very popularly, resume and curriculum vitae. So why are the two words? So curriculum vitae is a Latin word for course of life. That means it describes your course of life, what you have done up to now. Resume is a French word for sum it up. It's like a summary. A resume can be a one or two page, maximum two pages, with your work experience and background relevant to the job you are applying to. So you might have, you know, you have, might have done sports and everything, but if it's not relevant to the job you are applying, you can leave out the less important things and just keep the more important things there. But a CV is very long, longer than a resume, more than two pages. And did you know that it is more relevant to the academic people? When you are going for an academic career, it will be more relevant to list out all your experiences, including your publications like the research papers, like the certificates, patents, mostly for the academic purposes. So as a practice, in USA and Canada, they use the word CV for academic applications and resume for industrial applications. So in Sri Lanka, we are using the both words most of the time. So now this is a very interesting thing that I found out when I researched to collect material for this presentation. Recruiters take an average of 6 seconds to scan a resume. So you can see, like, you know, this report was published by an organization called The Ladders. You can see how their eyes move. There are like hot spots where their eyes will rest for a very little time. So it's up to you to make sure that they see everything about you within that short time. In non-academic environments, the term CV and resume are used almost interchangeably to refer to the same type of document, especially in Sri Lanka. So, first and foremost, your contact information. Why is contact information important? First of all, your recruiters are going to see where you live. If you are living in a faraway place, you have a little bit a low chance. For example, if the workplace is in Colombo, I think priority will be given to people living around Colombo. So your contact information is important for that, your address especially. And if you get, in the case you get selected for the job or the interview, you need to be contacted. So your contact information comes as the most important information. Next is research objectives. Professional profile. So if you are an academic, you're going to apply for academic career, you have to have what research objectives you are focusing on. Or as an industrial person, you have to have a professional profile. What you want as a professional, what you are seeking. Then comes your education, your academic or industrial appointments. Then if you are you have published articles as an academic, you can mention your books or book chapters, journals, research papers, peer review publications, so on and so forth. And even though you are an academic or non-academic, you can mention your awards and honors. The conferences you have published your papers in, things like that. And non-academic activities. Non-academic activities include your volunteer experiences. For example, if you are volunteering at the IEEE, EOIET, or the IESL student chapter, or something else, like maybe even the Astronomic Society, you can mention that in your non-academic activities, because this is important, because recruiters will know what you do in your free time. Are you using your time in a good way. And your memberships, of course. If you are an ISL or IET member, you have to mention that. And the references here mean who we can ask about you. Am I audible?
Yes, madam.
Yes, madam.
So now we'll go to how our CVs should be organized, the layout. First of all, you have to keep it simple. Use clear sections and headings. Don't make easy to read. Don't use dark colors, keep it professional as well. Now, if you can see this person, he has used the headings like technical skills, experience. So they are clearly divided. The sections are clearly divided. And on top, you can see he has mentioned his name, contact details, and the LinkedIn profile as well. So I'll come to that later about the LinkedIn profile. The second point, use a summary statement instead of an objective. Okay, so the summary is like who you are, what you want to do. I recommend you can write this summary after completing your CV. After you have included all the other things like your technical skills and work experience and educational achievements, come back and write the objective or statement. That is the best way. It's like the executive summary in a report. Okay. Who you are, what you are, what value you are going to give to that particular organization. And of course, spot is with you earlier. So if you have some key skills with regard to that job, particular job you are applying to, you can subtly, gently, not without making it a highlight or anything, highlight it, can make it a bullet point and bring the focus to that key skill to give you an advantage over the other applicants. And this is very important. Don't put your oldest experience first. Put your latest, the last experience you have as a project, even in a project or work experience, the last one, very recent experience, you should put that first and go in the chronological order, reversing order, and break it down. So we know that you and I, we are all sometimes lazy to read. So when we break it down and put it as much as in a summary, like in bullet points, it will be easy for the people to memorize what he did and what managed mobile app redesign from concept to launch, introduced more efficient layout. So these are the things that he did. And what were the results? Resulting in 15% additional downloads and 25% user engagement in 6 months. So you can see what he did and what he achieved. There always should be a result of what you did. And then most important, volunteer experience. So we know that when we were schooling, this volunteer experience was not a very cool thing. So I actually recommend all of you, if you can volunteer in any kind of organization out of your academic activities, it will be highly be useful for you to improve certain skills that doesn't come in your academic education. Okay? So like dealing with people, planning an event, executing something like, yes. So for example, if you are working in volunteering experience to give some aids to poor children, so you will be learning a new set of skills like collecting the finances, financing the project, and actually planning the logistics. But so there are so many things that you will be learning in volunteering in other organizations. And quantifying your bullets. So wherever possible, try to add numbers, the results, like percentages, durations. I hope you got it clearly. So we'll go on to the next slide. Okay. Now, when it comes to applying for even academic position, you will be asked to submit a CV. So applying for an academic position is actually very difficult than actually applying for an industrial job, because the details that you have to apply for an academic position is greater, because you have to list out all your academic publishing and things like that. But compared to that, applying to an industrial job is easy. So keep it to 2 pages. When you apply to an industrial position, keep it to 2 pages. Don't exceed 2 pages, because it won't give you an added advantage. And try to have a minimalist style and not very like gaudy design elements. Keep it professional, organized, and white spaces. Okay, I'll come to that later. Now you have to organize your content. How are you going to do that? There are 2 methods. First is the chronological. Start with your very recent experience or job and go backwards. That is one. Second method is skills based. So there is no like chronological order, not the date ordered in the date, but specific skill sets. Let me tell you why it is important. So for example, if there is a gap in your career, for instance, if you had to leave your job and go for personal some requirement, then there will be like a 2 or 3 month gap in your career. Then rather than going for the chronological order, it will be good to go to the skill-based order. Now, let me tell you something about online presence. Now, we know we all are majority of us are anyone. And there's Instagram, and there's LinkedIn. It's like the Facebook for the professionals. Twitter, blogs, YouTube. I've seen some great YouTube channels where undergraduates sometimes come and share their knowledge, but they have learned their research projects through YouTube. It's very good. The Snapchat. So this is so 87% LinkedIn, and sometimes Facebook as well. So yeah, I also have done this as a naive undergraduate when I was an undergraduate. Sometimes we tend to share things without thinking further about it on Facebook, don't we? So sometimes we are in a little bit of risk if a prospective recruiter takes a look at our profile. So we have to be mindful about that as well. So the idea is, just like in the Hansel and Gretel story, you have to leave a trail of breadcrumbs online about what you are passionate about as an undergraduate. So your profile, it has to be at the top of your resume. And don't write it at the beginning. First, complete your resume and all the important points. Then revisit your resume and summarize who you are as a person and what are the values you are going to add to that organization. Pick the accomplishments that match the job offer. So I have seen now, if you are applying for a telecommunication related job, you'd rather not include everything that you have done related to power and energy, so things like that. So you can fine tune your CV or resume based on the job you apply to, and quantify the achievements in the profile section of your resume. What are your achievements? And tailor your resume profile to a specific opening. So this is an example. Let's read it. Motivated and detail-oriented graduate from some university with a BS in accounting. Skilled in compiling and organizing data for invoicing, as well as collecting and managing campaign data reporting. So this person has fine-tuned his profile to match the job he's applying to. So we all can do that. So what are your skill set that you are going to bring some value to the particular position you are applying to? You can summarize your resume to every position you apply. It's always good to review your resume every time you are applying for a new post. And the personal mission statement. It can be a 1 to 2 sentence motto. How you define yourself as a person or a team member? Or what are you? What is your passion? For example, I want to do well by doing good while supporting and elevating those around me. That is one example. These are personal mission, mission status yourself as well. Another person says, embrace something bigger than yourself, continually improve your skills, inspire others to achieve great things, and make the world a better place. So this is maybe a little bit exaggeration. You don't have to go that extent, but you can summarize who you are. Are you focused on learning, sharing knowledge, making the world a better place, contributing to society as a citizen, things like that. So how to write a personal mission statement? So what you are going to do, to whom you are going to do that, and how you are going to achieve that. And as a result of that, what you are going to get to yourself. For example, most of the time, we look for personal satisfaction from a job, no more than anything else, more than the monetary benefits and the privileges that come with the position. Most people look for the job satisfaction. If the job satisfaction is not there, sometimes even though the salary is good, some people leave the jobs. There are many cases like that. So you know what's best for you. Find that yourself. So these are some examples. One person has said, use my project management skills to deliver efficiency and productivity. Create powerful software solutions that makes users' lives easier. Provide the best possible care to patients with maximum efficiency. That may be a doctor. Defend client rights against those who would subvert it. That should be a lawyer. Save time and money for my clients. That can be anyone. And hard skills. Now, these are the hands-on skills that you need. So when you have a job-specific duty or responsibility, some hard skills are required, like, you know, even project management skills, MS Project, Primavera, and what you call AutoCAD. These skills are required. These are hard skills. I mean, it doesn't involve people. Some of them involve people, like management skills, but most of these are things that you actually do. Practically do on the job. Designing, calculating, planning, executing, arranging, logistics, things like that. Okay, so for example, if you have some kind of skill and if you did something with that skill in your previous job, you will mention it like, for example, implemented team-wide use of Google Docs. So this is something most of us can easily implement when we go to a place and when we see that people are using hard copies. We can very easily use this freely available software to save our time and also save the information safely. Because, for example, a hard copy can easily get lost. If you can implement a Google Doc information sharing system, you can save time for yourself and your team as well. So then this person has implemented these three softwares and slashed project time to delivery 35%. That means he has increased delivery by 35% by resorting to solutions like this. Someone has said redesign budgeting methods to increase project delivery rate by 20%. That means there has been a budgeting method. This person has redesigned it, improved it, did some kind of change, and increase the delivery rate by 20%. So these are the skills that you acquire on the job, hard skills. Soft skills. Now, this is not something that you do directly in your job, but that comes as a part and parcel of your job when you're dealing with people mainly. So communication. So now, for example, you are having something in your mind, but when you speak, if you're telling something else or the person who listens to you get the different idea, sometimes it may lead to conflict. The best example is actually texting and emailing. Most of the time when we are texting, we are not seeing that person's face or facial expressions or how their emotions change. We even don't know what kind of situation they are in. I have experienced this firsthand. For example, when someone was having a tough time in her life without knowing that, I might have sent some kind of text, and that person, depending on the situation that she was, took it in a different way. So this is why communication is very important. So rather than just sending a text, it would be always better to talk over the phone or meet in person, better yet, because you can see their situation clearly. So communication is something very important when you're working on the job. Adaptability. Now, this is very useful nowadays because you know, you are young, you are second year and third year undergraduates, maybe fresh graduates as well. It's easy for you to adapt. But for the people who have been in the industry, it's somewhat tough to adapt. But as you know, when you can adapt, you can survive better. So when you go to different jobs, different places, you might have to adapt a little bit to suit those places because you can't go on the first day and change the place to suit your style. You might have to study it a little bit and maybe adapt a little bit yourself to that process, to those behaviors and the adapted methods. Leadership. Leadership is very important, especially when you are handling a team. When you are working with people and you need to achieve certain targets, certain outcomes from them without, I mean, you don't have to be, come off as a Hitler or someone, but you can be a balanced leader who can achieve both, I mean, the outcome as well and become a good resource manager as well. Time management, emotional intelligence, organization, collaboration, creativity, these are all the soft skills. And stress management. Mind you, nowadays, I don't know why, but I think due to the COVID situation and everything, people are going through a lot of stress than we used to. Blame it on the social media and news as well, because we are seeing a lot of negative things. So stress management is also an important skill. So there can be methods like adapting a habit, a good habit like maybe active listening. So most of the time we listen to reply, but if we can listen to understand better, that will be active listening. So these are the soft skills. So I'm not going to go in detail to this, but you have to be aware about this as well. And these are not taught in your curriculum, I mean, in your university. These you have to acquire by probably joining like maybe gavel clubs, maybe red clubs, volunteering in organizations. You can achieve them, acquire these skills informally. And self-learned. I learned a lot of these skills by self reading, basically reading and watching videos. So definitely you can too. Now let's come to the CV where we are writing our experience. These verbs like managed, achieved, acquired, designed, improved, these are called action verbs. And they clearly mention an action that you did during your, maybe your research project, maybe your undergraduate final year project, maybe a project that you did as a freelancer. What you did. For example, managed. The highly successful lean training project. So some of these words are very attractive. You can use them as well to make it look more attractive. Successful lean training project for 3 years. Improved quality by 32%. Cut lead times by 21%. And cut cost by 48%. So action verb, result, and duration. Then the work already done, you can use verbs like manage, develop, supervise, so on. So there is a problem. Carefully look at the statement. There is a problem which was there earlier. And you did something, an action, which resulted in a good result. Problem, action, result. Okay, so another example is poor internal communication has been a problem. Action is implementing an in-house newsletter, and the result is back and forth emailing reduced by over 1/3. So sometimes very simple things like attaching a checklist to a set of documents can save a lot of time. So what you achieve is important. So these come under analytical skills as well, because you go to a place, you observe what is the problem, and you implement a solution with good results. Analytical skills. Recruiters identify this very clearly. and the summary of writing your CV. Let's go on a recap. First thing is the layout, either the chronological or the skill-based format. And the subheadings, clearly divide your sections, making it easy to the recruiters to go through the subheadings. Fonts, very important. Sometimes I have seen in CVs and resumes, there are different fonts. At the beginning, there's Times New Roman, when it goes, it's Arial, and at the end, it's Verdana or Garamond. Don't do like that. Try to stick to one good-looking font. And 12 point is a good size. For section titles, you can use 14 to 16 point. And these CVs get printed and filed. So you have to keep that in mind when you are designing your CV. Keep the margins at least 1 inch on all sides of the page, A4 size. Line spacing, 1.15 is a good size, recommended size for single line spacing. And also leave wide space. So, you know, even when we are reading a book, if the text is going on continuously, it's very difficult. If there's a small space after a paragraph, it's more easy on the eyes. So similarly, leave some white space. Unless the job ad says otherwise, if they don't tell you to send a word, always save it as a PDF because it might get changed. We don't know what might happen on the way. So save it as a PDF before sending it. And after saving, also check whether it has been saved properly. Sometimes the fonts and the margins go here and there when you do the editing and save it as a PDF. So after converting into PDF also, you have to check. Header, relevant contact information should be there. Introduction, check. Work experience, history of your past job duties and achievements. Education. So this is very important. Now, you don't have to mention your O-level results actually when you're going to the industry, because obviously you have completed your O-levels and A-levels and then come to the university. So you don't have to include all your O-level results, like how many A's and things like that. And A-levels, of course, you have passed your A-levels and come to the university, that's clear. But you can mention your GPA if you are fresh entry level graduate. So you can mention your GPA and skills. Concise list of the most job-related abilities. Yes, don't do now. If you can, for example, I'm just telling you, I'm not degrading you. If you can scrape coconut, you are not going to apply that, add that to a CV when you apply for an IT position. So just keep that in mind. Only the skills that are relevant to that job. Extra sections like certifications and awards, these are very good. So if you even have achieved, another language, for example, like Tamil, sometimes it can be an added advantage. So don't forget to mention that. Yes, I get this question a lot. So that's why I have mentioned a slide in this. GPA. So if you are an experienced graduate, like if you have 2-3 year experience, it's not necessary to mention your GPA unless requested. But if you are an undergraduate going for industrial training, or a fresh graduate who just passed out, you should use your GPA in the CV. Okay. So sometimes there are instances where I have seen that people with high GPAs don't get selected. Instead, people with the second upper and third upper, third lower, like they get selected over the people with first class. Maybe when you mention your GPA like 4.0 without the skills, recruiters might think that you are the bookworm. So try to avoid that as much as possible. Extracurricular. Now, only in when we were entering the market as well, I think this was not a big issue. But nowadays, if you are doing extracurricular, it will be an added advantage, because what you lack in your experience can be compensated by what you have done to the society and your other skills. So keep that in mind. For example, I have mentioned here the student council or any other event management you have done. It shows that you have experience in planning an event, fundraising, teamwork, and you are self-motivated. That means nobody has to tell you to do this and that. You are self-motivated and you will do it by yourself. So that is why extracurricular activities is important in your CV. And my dear students, this is very important. Before you apply for a job, study about that company. You can go to maybe the news sites or the website of the company and get to know what they are doing before applying. So this is very useful. Sometimes your background search will not hurt you. And it will also include in the CV when you get to know about your employer better and plan your journey. You should be able to plan your journey and have a clear idea of where you want to be in a few years. I mean, it's not that you always will end up in your end in mind, but if you have a plan, at least you can work on it rather than having no idea about where you want to go. Okay, so research the company, read the job specification very carefully. Make sure you have so prepare the documents. The CV, you can take printouts of your final year project or maybe the presentation you did when you were presenting it and research papers, things like that. It will be useful to have a small portfolio. Yes. Remember, customize your CV for each job application. And if you have certification like CCNA, CIMA, please include them as well. Any faculties of engineering in Sri Lanka, but what makes you special is how you stand out from the crowd. So instead of trying to copy everyone else, trying to unique person with a unique set of skills.
Sorry,
I lost my correction. Maybe where did I stop?
Madam, you were doing the part about the sample CV. You had the sample CV slide on.
Where did I stop? I mean, when you was
I? Yeah, madam, the sample CV.
Yeah, okay.
About making it unique.
So I'm having a little bit bad weather here. Maybe that's why I'm having a bad internet connection. So anyway, let's continue. So this is a sample of work experience. So you have seen that it is in chronological order, latest experience first. And he or she has mentioned where she worked. This can be an industrial training as well, June to September, like 3 months, 12-week PR and communication internship, where and what is the company. And what he or she has done, she has clearly mentioned, provided organizational support, devised and presented. Now, very careful, I will share this presentation with you. Please read these words carefully. Go through these words. These are the action verbs that can add some like very good feeling to your CV when you are reading. Devised means create a plan. Develop, something like develop. Negotiated and organized. Checked and updated. Monitored. So these are the action verbs. And as you can see, there are results, and so problem has been solved as a result of this action. Another sample, volunteering achievements. So 2018 to present, someone has been the secretary of somewhere, and what he or she has done as a secretary. These are the things like, you know, this shows your skills, not as only an engineer, but how well you work with the society, with people, how well you manage the resources. So you can see there's like, you know, increased membership by 10%. That means you are a good marketer, which made $500 profit. That means you are a good person who can raise funds. Promoted the society, again, public relations, organized management committee meeting, how well you are an organizer. IT skills. So if you are going for IT-related job, then you have to have certain skills in certain software. So you have to mention those. So you have to be very aware about what your recruiter employer is looking out for. How do you acquire these skills? So not like when we were kids, when we were young. Nowadays, most of the information is available on the internet. There are many YouTube channels and LinkedIn, for example. This is why I want to highlight you. Please start an account in LinkedIn, because they are, apart from the benefits that you get, like getting in touch with prospective employers, you also find some free courses, free webinars offered as CPD even. So you can learn a lot if you have a LinkedIn account. I still learn a lot because of my LinkedIn account. And you can do projects. So for example, it might not be in your curriculum, but you can research and develop something in like an invention. It can be an invention. You can develop something into something better. Even an existing solution you can develop if you have the interest. DIY means do it yourself. That's why it's called. And learn how to use online medium. Yes, please. Now, this is very important, my dear students. I want to tell you, nowadays, sometimes your interviews will be conducted online due to the pandemic situation. So you have to be what we call in Sinhala, Zoom kala vathuru beela, like that. If you can be well versed in using Zoom and Google Meet and Microsoft Teams, it will definitely be an advantage to you, because even after starting the job, example, you need to take some decision. Instead of going to the office, you could be able to gather your people, your team, in a Zoom meeting and discuss and take a decision. So very important. Acquire these skills. And if you lack communication skills like speaking, don't worry, you can develop that. It is a skill that can be learned. So you can join the Cavalier Club if it's there in the university, or a Toastmasters Club, or something else even that is convenient for you. If self-learning is good for you, you can go for that. Somehow try to develop yourself as a better communicator. Try to improve. Research. You can research about an interesting topic and try to publish. You can always get help from one of your lecturers or some senior, and you can publish articles. And this is not a new concept, mentoring and coaching, but it is now discussed with great popularity, finding a mentor and coach. So actually, this is what our seniors did when we went to the university. First, they guided us on which modules to select, how to study, and all of that. So try to have that mentor coaching relationship with someone who is good for you. It will definitely be helpful for you to get advices, and sometimes even in establishing contacts with the industry. So find a mentor or coach. It can be in your university or in your workplace, your lecturers, someone. Don't be isolated. I mean, don't try to think that you know it all and do it all by yourself. Try to be in touch with people as much as possible. Some information you might not know if you are not communicating. So get together with friends with same interest. So friends play a very important role in your life. So don't forget that you are all studying with the state sponsored funds. So we have a duty to give back to our country. So don't divert from your original route. Keep your end in mind. You're going to be an engineer with a good career. So select suitable friends and keep on learning. Learning never ends. So some people I have seen, they say, I'm done and dusted with the degree. No, you never can be done and dusted. You have to keep on learning, and you have to improve your CV as well. So these are some references that I referred to, including the Bullseye book by Brian Tracy. If you can go through it, I will share this presentation with you. So I hope you got some kind of idea regarding to how to clearly prepare your CV.
Madam, Thank you, madam. So now we are moving into the Q&A session. The participants can direct questions either through the chat box. So if you want to direct the question to madam directly, you can send a message in the chat box saying you have a question and wait till I call your name. And also the participants who have joined us through Facebook Live can direct their questions through the comment sections. So we already have a few questions. Madam, the first question is, writing a CV, should we include the volunteering participated at school? Do they count?
Muted. Yes, if you don't have like recent volunteering experiences, you can include this. So it could be because you have to travel or some because you are very busy with your studies, you're catching up with other things, you might not be able to do volunteering while being an undergraduate. But if you have experience in school, you can add them. Even colors awards.
Thank you, madam. Madam, the next question is also through the chat box. And it's that if you have done lots of online certifications related to our career, do we have to mention all of them in the CV?
So if you have run out of the important points that you have mentioned all the other and you have space, like you should not exceed the 2-page limit. If you have a little bit more space left, you may choose some good, like, you know, the certifications that are relevant to that job. You don't have to list out everything. The certifications that are relevant to that job, you may mention those.
Thank you, madam. Just a note for everyone. You can also send a message on the Zoom chat box saying that you have a question and you can unmute yourselves and ask the question as well. So, madam, the next question is, for the industrial training, should it be a CV or a resume?
This is like, it depends on the name the employer is using. So most of the time in Sri Lanka, we use CV, but the CV will be limited to 2 pages. The name, regardless of the name, when you apply for an industrial job, it should be limited to 2 pages.
Okay, madam. Thank you, madam. Madam, we have a question from the... Madam, we have another question on the Zoom chat box. It is it good to have a portfolio about our details like projects, experiences? And if we are creating a portfolio, do we have to create it from scratch by coding it? Or is it okay to use an online template?
Yes, it's always good to have a portfolio. Even I took one when I applied, went to the job in CEB with my final year project presentation. And a paper that was written for that. And you can take anything that you have done, if you have a small, information about that, even an online information, if the interviewer or the person who is talking to you is interested to know more about, you can quickly show it by your phone even. For example, if you are a software engineer, if you have launched an app or something, you can show that app. So it's always good to have a portfolio with your certificates, your other achievements. Take it when you're going to the interview. They might ask for it or they might not, but you being prepared is a good sign for them.
Thank you, madam. Madam, we have a question from viewers from Facebook Live. And it is that if someone's goal is to go for higher studies, what kind of qualification should we apply in CV? In what fields should they focus? And if someone is having an idea to be a researcher, what area should they focus on? I'll repeat it, madam. Yes. It was a question with 3 parts. And the first part is that if someone's goal is to go for higher studies, what kind of qualification should we apply in CV? And the second part is, in what fields should they focus? And third part is, if someone is having an idea to be a researcher, what area should they focus on?
Okay, so the first thing is, you have to always include your research publications, research-related things in the CV if you are going to higher studies. So that means you are going to be an academic in the future. So you will be more focused on academia and researching. In what fields should they focus? I think this should be in regard to the CV, or maybe the information that should be included in the CV. So research experience will be more important to be focused on if you are going to be a researcher. And if someone is having idea to be a researcher, so that this is actually, it should be your area of interest. So if you are interested in renewable energy, then your area of focus will be renewable energy. Thing that is relative to person to person. So at the end of the day, you have to select this, what you want to do.
Thank you, madam. That was clearly a very comprehensive answer. The next question is, question to clarify, if anyone is not qualified for the vacancy, do companies hire the most valued person? If anyone is not qualified for the vacancy, do companies hire the most valued person?
Yes, they do have a marking scheme. Most companies have a marking scheme. Then when they interview, individually there will be a panel, and they will at the end of the day add the marks, and if no one is qualified, they will select the person with the highest marks.
Thank you, madam. The next question is, if I have conducted a project related to the development of a society within brackets school, is it good to add it to proof or not?
Most of the time, what we add as volunteer work, there is no proof. They will just ask about it. Most probably they will ask it about it during the interview. Then you have to be very convincing. So it's better be genuine. My thoughts are you should be genuine. Even though you don't have proof, there's no problem in adding it to the CV.
Thank you, madam. Madam, the next question is about interviews, madam. It's about whether our GPA is going to be considered in the interview panel, by the interview panel.
Some recruiters do, but some people don't. Actually, if you see, there's a misconception, actually. Some recruiters think that people with high GPA are very bad when it comes to actually doing the job. That's just like that feeling. But it all depends on how you face the interview. Even though you might have a 4.0 GPA, how will you defend yourself in the interview will at the end of the day decide your destiny. So I also personally have, you know, experienced this. There are some really academically very qualified students, but when it comes to communication skills, sometimes they are a little bit behind to the others. So this is why I want to tell. So if you are lacking in one area, communication skills, for example, it's not the end. You can work on that. Please work on that. So in vain, if you are using an opportunity just because you don't have the good communication skills, it's such a waste of talent.
Thank you, madam. Can we get the presentation slides shared in the meeting right now?
Yes. How can I share it? Shall I
madam,
put it in the chat box?
Yeah, madam. Yeah. If you could upload the link to the slides on the chat box.
I'll upload it.
Sure. Thank you, madam.
Right. I am uploading. Right.
Okay. Thank you, madam. Madam, then moving on, madam, to the next question. It's that do we have to put a declaration at the end of the CV? Like, for example, I hereby declare that the aforesaid particulars are true. Okay, thank you, madam.
If you are signing and sending it, then it better be there. But if you are emailing it, I think, you know, you can just send it by the email. Am I unstable, my internet connection?
It's okay now, madam. It was a bit lagging earlier.
Was I audible?
Yes, madam. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, madam.
Yeah.
Madam, the next question is, while making tailored CV/resume, should we be including our publications, projects, research, if they are not directly related to the competencies asked by the company?
Yes, if you really need to include them, include them at the, you know, give them the last priority, not the top priority. And if you are using a list, so number 1, 2, 3 should be given to the things that are relevant to the job. And if you have something that is not that relevant, you can use it at the end of the list. No worries.
Thank you.
Have space, don't try to exceed
madam,
the two-page two-page rule is important.
Thank
how
you.
To address a gap in academic
madam, the next question is professional timing.
Yes, that's what. If you have a gap, try not to go to the chronological order. You can make it up with the skills-based order. You have to be tactful when you are making your CV. If you have a gap, you can go for the skill-based order without the chronological order. Or if you have a gap, you should be able to answer the employer if they are asking, why do you have the gap? So if it's like in a valid reason, like, you know, you had a personal issue or something that was unavoidable, it's acceptable, of course. So be tactful and use the skill-based order rather than the chronological order.
Thank you, madam. Madam, the next question is, in a resume, does membership of a professional organization help?
Yes, it does. Especially if you have a membership in IET or IESL, even the student membership. It helps.
Thank you, madam. Madam, we have another question. It's also about an interview, and it says that if an interviewee has a GPA below 3.5, but that person has a lot of extracurricular activities, what weighs more, GPA or extracurricular activities?
Personally, in my point of view, I would go for a person who is good in the real world work rather than the GPA. So even the recruiters, they want people who will work. They are not going to look at the marks. They want people who will actually go out there and take the decisions and face the difficulties, challenges, and do the things. So if you have extracurricular activities, it clearly means that you have already those skills in you. So I think those have an advantage.
Thank you, madam. Madam, the next question is it necessary to include an image on the resume?
Yes, basically it's not important, but I see nowadays everyone is including an image. So it's not a bad idea as well, but be careful to include an image that looks very professional. For example, don't wear t-shirts and casual dresses. It's better if you can wear like a professional with the tie for the guys, and the girls, you can wear something like a good blouse and comb your hair and don't be frowning or something like that. Look good. So as long as the image that you are including is a good image, go ahead. No worries.
Thank you, madam. So everyone, madam is a very experienced personality in this
no,
regard.
No, and actually not experienced, Puta.
But
this is something that I have seen and learned from my juniors. Actually, juniors and undergraduates like you, most of the time, they have reached out to me with asking help for their CVs. And I have seen a lot of things that can be improved. For example, I share my screen again. Okay.
Sure.
If you can stop, I think. There's this document I quickly made of the common mistakes. Okay. So there are like small things, spelling mistakes sometimes that you don't pay attention to. Because actually, I also have that drawback when I'm doing something, we don't pay attention to the spellings and things. But when it comes to sending your CV to an organization, you have to be careful. For example, the first image here, it shows the first the CV that the person sent to me. And when reading, I actually read letter by letter very carefully. Then I found small mistakes like testing and commissioning. There can be like, you know, project substation, battery banks and chargers. So it should be plural. So I made that correction. And there was hypo test and primary injection. Yeah, he has mentioned primary injection. So it should be primary injection testing. Simple things like that I noticed. And here, see, someone has missed the E in the profile. And another very popular mistake is carrier. So you know that the spellings for carrier that we use, I'll put it in the chat box, should be this. Okay, this is the correct one. But most of the time I see undergraduates using this wrong spellings. Okay, this is wrong. So you have to be mindful about these small mistakes as so communication. You can see that this is a wrong. This is carrier means you are carry something that is used to carry something. Even professionals who are working do these mistakes. So it's always good. Even I myself personally, when I upgrade my CV, I send it to someone and get a review. You can do it with your colleagues because we are good at finding faults of others. It naturally comes to us rather than our faults. So you can always send it to someone and get it reviewed.
So true, and thank very very mighty thank you for that very eye-opening explanation, madam. We have another question. Due to pandemic situation, do companies change their requirements when recruiting, and do they have like any special qualifications?
Yes, now basically nowadays I think work from home is gaining popularity. So they might ask you and expect you to work from home. So you must have a good setup at your home, like a good internet connection, for example. So even myself, I'm facing some difficulties today. So if you have a good internet connection, if you are facing a lot of power interruptions again, your work from home will be difficult to do. Now, blame it on CEB actually. So things like that. And you should be able to handle software like TeamViewer sometimes, Zoom, meeting software and things that enables you to work with your team while being in a remote place. Now, for example, even if you're traveling, I know some people, although they travel, they should be able to do some work by carrying their laptop. So some companies expect that.
Thank you, madam.
Flexibility. It comes under flexibility. That means you should be flexible to certain work hours as well sometimes.
Thank you, madam. We have another question regarding the field that madam specializes in. And it's that if someone is thinking about joining CEB, what are the skills he or she should improve? Is it the GPA/project experience or the soft skills that matter?
Yes, when it comes to CEB, actually, personally, I think soft skills matter a lot because CEB is a very vast organization with so many branches, so many divisions, so many people in different levels working. So it's not about what you learned in theory that comes into practice. So soft skills plays a great role. So plus, if you have a special area of interest and that you're passionate about, for example, if you're interested in protection, you can go to the protection branch. If you're interested in condition monitoring and managing assets, you can go to the asset management branch. If you are interested in working in a coal power plant, you can go to the coal power plant. So it should be the interest and the dedication should be there as well, because sometimes you are sent to a place without your preference as well. Then you have to be flexible and adapt to the workplace as well. So soft skills.
Thank you, madam. How do we give them a quantifiable measurement about interest and dedication using our CV?
Good question. Yes, very good question. So, for example, if you are interested in something, for example, you can say you can start a blog about it. If you are writing a blog about something that you are interested, it clearly shows that you are consistently trying to gain knowledge with relevant to that area and share the knowledge as well. Now, knowledge sharing is a very good characteristic for an engineer. So I recommend to you, if you are interested in some area, the very best way to show your employee recruiter is start writing a blog. Or, you know, vlog, even a vlog, you can do small videos about how to code a certain application, things like that.
Thank you, madam. Taking the topic about blogs and like social media stuff, recently I came across a news that said about a nursery teacher who was like taken off her job because of a photo on her social media account. So things like that, madam, should we do our employees like have us like basically do this talk us on social media, or is it was that a random occurrence?
Now think, we cannot, in the current world, we cannot avoid social media. My personal view is we cannot, it's there, we have to go with it. But the manner we use it, if we are using it to, for example, tarnish the image of our employer in any manner, then there is a problem with it. But if we are using it to uplift the image of our profession, uplift the image of our employer, I think there's nothing wrong with it. And it depends on the purview or the attitude of the employer as well. So you can't, you know, go with the hanimiti adhas, as we tell. You have to go with the world when it's going, go with the flow. But we can use anything, any technology. For example, even dynamite, it could have been used for good things, but it was used for bad things. So as engineers, we know how to use the tools that are available in a good way, that is contributing to the society. So that is my opinion. So when you're using any tool, including social media, try to make the message that you're sending to the society a positive, inspiring, good one, motivating one.
Thank you, madam. Madam, we have a question. On a scale of 1 to 10, how important is personal branding for fresh graduates?
Yes, Bhuta. Now you are a new product. You are going to the society as a new product. So it's very important. So trying to copy someone else. So most of the time that we fail in life is also because we try to copy or go in the path that someone else has. So rather than that, if you can find out who you are, what you are, what you are passionate about, that is your personal branding. So if sharing knowledge is your personal passion, so knowledge sharing is your personal branding. You will be known as a person who likes to share knowledge.
Thank you, madam.
So if you are interested in robotics, so robotics will be your personal branding. So this person, for example, if Pesala is interested in robotics, people will know, okay, who should you get advice about robotics? Okay, Pesala is there, you can ask him. So that is the branding you should develop yourself.
Personal branding, is it like totally limited to the CV, or could we use things like our social media accounts as well, like as madam said, the blogs and stuff, to also do the personal branding? Is that effective?
Can you elaborate more what you mean by
madam,
that question?
Say I have an Instagram account that I post daily on stuff like robotics and stuff. So would that play a role, would that play an effective role in my personal branding, or would it not be as important?
It will. That shows, you live for robotics. Your passion is robotics. You are living, breathing and eating and doing everything on robotics. So that is your personal brand.
Thank you.
So that's what I told. Even social media can be used in a good way. You can influence people to do good things.
Thank you. Madam, we have another question in the chat box. Can you give us some good tips in maintaining a standard LinkedIn profile? Second part of the same question, madam, how to promote ourselves in LinkedIn?
Yes, basically, you first have to start the LinkedIn account. upload a good picture of yourself, and just like an online CV, LinkedIn is similar to an online CV. Try to include your skills, your achievements, your work experience, your educational qualifications in that. So that basically will help you to have a good standard LinkedIn account. Do you know that you can download your LinkedIn account as a CV? I mean, when you download your information, it comes like a resume CV. So if you keep it up to date, you won't have a hard time creating your CV. You can take the information from there easily. So it's very important. Maintain the information currently. Update it frequently. And to be seen, promote yourself. Keep sharing things that you are interested about. For example, if I'm interested about condition monitoring and sometimes transformers, so I keep sharing about that. And Toastmasters sometimes. So things I'm passionate about, I keep sharing. Sometimes I even share small podcasts or videos I have done on LinkedIn. So yeah, it's not bad to, you know, what you call blow your own horn if it's a good thing that you are doing. So celebrities do that. So why can't we engineers do that? We can promote ourselves.
Thank you, madam. Madam, we have another question in the chat box. Do we have to put our all-level results in CV? Is it a waste of space?
Yes, Puta. Actually, if you have nothing else and if you need to fill a gap, you can put your all-level results. But taking up that space, like something trivial as all-level, because definitely you have passed all-level, you have passed A-levels, and you are the cream of the country. You are engineering undergraduates. So it's actually trivial information, all-level results. You can add which year you did the all-levels and how many passes, one sentences. If you got 10 A's, 10 A's. That's all. That's enough. Don't go to list all the subjects you did.
Madam, on the note of O-level and A-level results, madam, can we add things like our island ranks? If you have a good island rank, can we...
If you have a good island rank, you can blow, you know, brag a little bit about yourself. This is something that engineers don't do, actually. We tend not to brag about ourselves, but there's no harm.
Madam, so essentially, should a CV be an extroverted document or should it be an introverted document?
Extroverted. You should try to, you know, it's like your photo to the world, what you are, who you are. So you are summarizing your whole personality and the values that you are going to give to that organization in your CV. So try to make it as, don't keep the information, important information to yourself. If there's some important information that you think others should know, let it be there. Engineers do that. Engineers normally don't like to talk about themselves. I know this very well. They are more introverted, but when it comes to the CV, try to be extrovert. Oh, get your help from your good friends. Because you don't see your value, but someone who is looking at you might see your value more than you.
Madam, when we try to do an extroverted CV, would that seem a bit like we come off as a bit strong or as a bit arrogant, things like that?
That is why you have to always get a review. You can get your review from even your references, the people you are adding as your references. Just talk to them. I mean, some people are very helpful. You just have to ask for help. So if it comes off as arrogant, you can ask them, does this sound arrogant? What do you feel about this?
Sure. Thank you. Madam, there's another question in the chat box. Regarding fresh graduates, how can a fresher identify their interested area? I personally experienced I was attracted to popular fields, but sometimes it's not always the correct choice.
Good thing. So there's something like called, because I read a lot normally, I understand it. So look at the things that you like most. And when you are doing something, if you like have a flow, I mean, when you start to do that thing, you are lost to the world. You are not bothered about what goes around you. You are so lost in it, immersed in it. It's so interesting to you. That is your passion. But if something feels like, even though you like it, if something feels like a burden, ayyo me monawa deyakda, so that is not your area of interest. So you can easily identify that when you are doing something. If you forget everything else, even the time and your food or what time you sleep, if you are so lost in it, that is your area of interest.
Thank you, madam. Madam, we have reached the end of our Q&A session. Thank you for your answers, madam, and thank you everyone for asking questions and enlightening everyone else as well.
Yes, so please send me that feedback if possible.
Sure.
Because I need to improve myself. I'm also a continuous learner. So you guys go ahead and give me your feedback. Also, I like to help you with your CVs. This is my email address to everyone. Yes. If you need to get your CV checked, you can send it to me. Free of charge, okay? There are people who charge actually, but I'm doing it free of charge.
This means a lot, madam. Thank you. So thank you very much, madam. So before we move on to the vote of thanks, I have two small requests to make from everyone. If you can kindly switch on your cameras to take the group photo, and also there's a special virtual background whose link was in the chat box that you guys can download, and then you can apply for the photo. So can everyone please be kind enough to keep your videos on?
Okay.
Dear participants, could you download and apply the virtual background and turn on your videos? Nice, we have a few more people to turn on the videos. So can everyone please turn on your videos? Thank you, madam, and thank you, everyone. Guys, also do note, we have shared the link for the feedback form in the chat box. If you guys enjoyed the session, or if you guys feel like there's room to improve, if you guys feel like we could improve on this also, please spare a few minutes and give your feedback about the webinar. So thank you guys for that too. And finally, madam, thank you for gracing our webinar with your presence. Words can't capture how helpful and important your insights have been to us. Your answers, your replies to our questions have opened our eyes in many ways. So we thank you once again for your time, and please accept our token of appreciation.
And I would like to add few words. I wish you all the very best for bright careers, and pay it forward. If you find someone to share your knowledge, pay it forward.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, everyone, as well. Now, I would like to cordially invite webinar co-chairperson Hansika Gibhani to deliver the vote of thanks. Over to you, Hansika.
Good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Madam Sara Marston for joining me today and for enlightening us with the knowledge and experiences. When talking about today's webinar, it gave deep insights into the topic CV writing and also revealed some interesting facts. I'm pretty sure the precious knowledge that Madam Sara gave us will definitely help us in our future. Thank you very much all of you who have participated today and made this event successful. Then a special thanks to the organizing committee for their unflinching support and coordination. So we are moving to the end of today's webinar. Please keep touch with IEEE student branch of University of Moratuwa for our future events. Our next webinar will be held on 13th March 2021 at 6 p.m. on topic How to Excel in an Interview. Once again, our heartiest thanks to you all for your participation. Stay safe. Good night.
Thank you, Hansika. Now, we have reached the end of the first phase of the Rise Up Mora webinar series. A big thank you to everyone who participated today. Please do give your feedback for our webinar by filling the Google form we have shared in the chat box. And the second phase of the Rise Up Mora webinar series would kick off on the 13th March at 6 p.m. on the topic How to Excel in an Interview. It is sure to get you many points for landing your dream job. Looking forward to seeing everyone there. Once again, thank you all for your Thank you all for your participation. Good night.
Thank you, madam. Good night.